We are in control of your television set. We control the vertical. We control the horizontal. We control the focus. We control the view. And you are in our control. You are about to enter the strange, the terrifying world of comic books.
I'm Bob Jeschonek, and I'd like to welcome you to the latest edition of Comic Book World, the TV show which is dedicated exclusively to comic books. Now, many of you out there might not be reading comic books anymore. You may have given them up a long time ago because, well, you might have heard they weren't too mature and they weren't meant for older readers. Well, I've got news for you. Comic books have changed. They're a lot different today than they were, say, 5 or 10 years ago. Comic books are appealing to wider audiences, and they're providing a very good variety of quality entertainment. I think you'd be surprised if you took a look at some of the books which are available right now at just how good they are and just how much you might enjoy them. I like to think of comic books as just another form of entertainment, sort of like TV shows or movies or a good book. Comic books have changed a lot, and I think if you give them a chance, you won't be sorry. As a matter of fact, we're going to talk about comic books tonight, and I'm going to discuss a couple of books which are available right now, either on the newsstands or through comic book specialty shops. And I'm going to tell you what I think of them, whether I think they're good or bad, and whether I think you'll enjoy them. I'm going to try to give you a rough idea of what comic books you should take a look at and which ones you might want to avoid. So let's get started. Now, the first comic which we're going to take a look at right now is a book called Suicide Squad. Now, this has a strange title, but don't worry. It doesn't have anything to do with taking your own life. As a matter of fact, it's a pretty darn good book, and I've enjoyed it a great deal. This is only issue 2 of the series. It's published by DC Comics. You can buy it at your local newsstand or at bookstores in the area. You don't have to go to a comic book specialty shop to get it, and that's definitely an advantage. But it's a very good book, and it surprised me a lot because their last appearance before the series started was in a comic book called Secret Origins. And Secret Origins basically tells about how superheroes and superhero groups come to be. In other words, how they got started, what made them decide to fight crime or do whatever they're doing. And Secret Origins is a book devoted entirely to that type of story, telling about how superheroes get started. And the Suicide Squad's adventure in Secret Origins was not very good. And on the last edition of Comic Book World, I panned it pretty soundly. I didn't enjoy it at all. It was pretty horrible. The art just did not work, and the story was very simplistic. It tried to take into account over 40 years of history, and it just did not work. It was too long and too boring. It just wasn't very good. Well, imagine my surprise when I picked up Suicide Squad's first issue of their own comic book and found that it was very good. I liked it a lot, and I liked the second issue as well. It's a very exciting book. It's somewhat along the lines of The Magnificent Seven, or especially The Dirty Dozen. And it's a story about some super villains, you know, the characters who battle superheroes in the regular DC comic books. And these super villains have been imprisoned. They were beaten by their respective enemies and put in jail. Now, a man named Colonel Richard Flagg comes around to the various prisons where the supervillains have been taken into custody, and he offers them a chance at freedom. He says if the supervillains will work for him and the United States government, they will be able to go free. This is a great deal. The supervillains, of course, all jump at the chance. I mean, they could get out of prison and go out and loot and pillage all over again and just have a good old time. But the catch is, the missions on which these supervillains are supposed to go are not real easy. As a matter of fact, they're downright suicidal. Hence the title of the group, The Suicide Squad. They're set out to do missions that no one else could do, that no right-minded hero would ever think of trying to tackle. These guys are sent out as cannon fodder because the government does not want to risk the lives of its better agents who know better than to undertake these type of missions. It's a very interesting premise, as I said, somewhat along the lines of The Dirty Dozen, only with superhero outfits. And it makes for a pretty good book. Suicide Squad number 2 is a continuation of a story in which the Suicide Squad battles a group of terrorists. And this group is called the Jihad. That's a word which means holy war in an Arabic language. And the Suicide Squad is sent to the Middle Eastern nation of Karak, obviously a fictional nation, and they're sent out to destroy this terrorist group because these terrorists are pretty ruthless and they're bent on attacking the United States and killing innocent civilians and causing untold damage and havoc. And the Suicide Squad is sent out to stop them in their tracks before they can get any further. It makes for a pretty good story. It really does. It sounds a little far out, and you may be thinking, well, super villains and super terrorists and everything else, boy, this is corny, but it really isn't. It makes for a pretty interesting book, and it's very exciting. It is written by a man named John Ostrander, who is famous in the comic book world for doing a comic series called Grimjack. It's a very realistic detective science fiction series, which is published by First Comics. It's very good, and Ostrander lives up to his potential in Suicide Squad. He really does a good job, and I've got to admit, I was surprised. I didn't think it would work. The basic idea did not seem too interesting, and I was I just was not looking forward to the book at all. But it turned out to be pretty good. Like I said, it's somewhat along the lines of The Dirty Dozen. So if you enjoy that type of movie or that type of TV show, I think you'll like this a lot. It's got some excellent art in it by Luke McDonnell, who was popular for doing the art in the old Iron Man comic book at Marvel just about 3 or 4 years ago. And the art is very good. I think you'll like Suicide Squad. I think you should give it a try. This is issue 2. It is currently available on your local newsstands or bookstores, and I recommend it highly. Now, the next book which we're going to talk about is called The Nom. Now, this is a little different from The Suicide Squad. It's a very stark and realistic book. It's about the Vietnam War, and it's very, very, very good. I can't emphasize how excellent this book is. This is issue number 7 of The Nom, and it is a very fine book, believe me. It's about the Vietnam War, and it portrays it through the eyes of the men who fought the war, through the eyes of the grunts who were sent out into the field and told to kill the Viet Cong. And it's a very interesting series. It's published by Marvel Comics. And generally, Marvel Comics does not put out material of this high caliber. Generally, their books are aimed at a younger audience. But the NOM is appropriate for audiences of all ages. It does not contain any explicit sex or language or references to drugs or even gore. It, as a matter of fact, uses a rather cartoony art style. But don't let that fool you. It is a very stark and foreboding portrayal of the Vietnam War. If you like the movie Platoon, you will love The NOM, because this is just as good as Platoon. It takes the same honest, realistic approach to the Vietnam War that that movie took, and it is very, very good. This issue is issue 7, and it contains a fantastic story, which is about the Viet Cong and why they fought the Vietnam War. It's a very unusual point of view, because generally in films or books about the Vietnam War, the story is only told through the eyes of the American soldiers. You never really get to understand exactly why the Vietnamese were fighting us, and why we were fighting them, of course, was obvious. But the Viet Cong just have never been portrayed in any kind of human way. They're always just shown as the Orientals running away from the Americans and hiding and shooting at us from the bushes of Vietnam in the jungles. But this book is very good, and it portrays a man who originally fought for the Viet Cong and then switched sides and decided to join the United States forces in battling against the army which he originally served with. This story is very, very good. It is very realistic, as I said before. It tells about how this man changes and how he begins the story fighting for something that he believes in, and then he sees this belief of his just crushed by the terrible things which occurred in his native land, and then eventually he turns and comes over to the American side. It's a very good book. It really is. The art is magnificent, and the story is just beautiful. And I think if you want to get an unusual perspective on the Vietnam War, you ought to take a look at this issue in particular of The NOM. It's issue 7. It's available at your local newsstands. You don't have to go to a comic book specialty shop to get it. And I think you should really try to make an effort to read this book. It's just like Platoon, and if you like that movie, you're going to like this comic. I guarantee it. Moving right along, the next book which we're going to talk about is called Batman. Now, lately, the comic book company, which publishes the adventures of the superhero called Batman, has taken some time and put some effort into renovating the character. They've been trying to change him to update him to the 1980s and try to freshen him up a little bit. Over the past couple years, the Caped Crusader has gotten a little stale. He wasn't quite as popular as he was in the past. He wasn't selling as many comic books as he used to, and the comic book company figured it was high time to give the man a little change of pace. So they went and published a series called The Dark Knight, which was out last year. It was an excellent book, which told about Batman in the future and how he returns after retirement to save Gotham City. It was a fantastic book. It revitalized interest in the character, and it led to additional attempts to make the character into a new hero. Now, this is issue 409 of Batman. It's titled Batman: The New Adventures, and it's the latest in a series of comics which are trying to show how the Batman is now different and how he's a more interesting character. Now, this issue basically centers around the Batman's meeting with the new Robin. Now, the original Robin was, of course, Dick Grayson, and he was around for quite some time, and then the publishers at DC Comics decided that it was time for him to move on. He had been around for so long, and he was still a kid. They figured, well, it's time for Robin to grow up, so they made him into a new character called Nightwing, and they spun him off into a book called The New Teen Titans. He's now the leader of that group of superheroes. But once Robin was gone, they found that Batman's series just wasn't quite the same without him. So they decided to bring in a new Robin. Now, many of you might not even know this. If you haven't been following the comic books yourselves, you probably haven't even heard that there's a new Robin, but there is. He's a kid called Jason Todd. And originally, he had an origin story similar to the first Robin. He was the child of a family of circus acrobats. His parents were killed by a ruthless gangster who was trying to extort money from the circus, which they worked for. And the Batman helped Jason get his revenge and battle the gangster, and he became Batman's new sidekick, the new Robin. Now, Robin has been around for a couple of years. The new Robin, Jason Todd, has been around for a while. But in changing Batman, the comic book company decided to change the new Robin. This really doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. It seemed to me that they had already brought in a new character that established him for probably about 3 years as the new Robin, and they had told his story and how he came to be, and he had been having adventures with the Batman for quite some time, actually, for a lot of issues of Batman's comics. But now they've changed it all around. They've said, well, that was just a fictional story. Of course, they're all fictional stories, but they're saying that that didn't really happen in the comic books. They said that, well, Jason Todd was not really the child of a family of circus acrobats. He was actually a child of the streets. His mother was an alcoholic and a drug addict, and Jason was forced to fend for himself, and he was committing petty crimes, and he eventually stole the wheels off of Batman's Batmobile, and Batman took him under his wing as the new Robin. Now, this is actually pretty silly. I don't like the whole idea at all. In the first place, it was kind of strange that they decided to change Robin and give him a new origin story, and this new story just does not seem to work very well. I don't understand what the motivation behind it was, but apparently they thought it was going to freshen up the character somewhat. Well, anyhow, this issue is not real good. It's about how Batman helps the new Robin to escape from a bad school for boys, which is called Ma Gunn's School for Boys. See, the Batman originally sent Jason to this school to help him to become a better citizen, but the Batman didn't know that it was operated by a little old lady who is actually a criminal. So when Jason Todd went to the school, he was surrounded by mean people, and he found out quickly that it was not a nice place to be and that it was actually not quite on the up and up. Anyhow, this issue is about how Batman has his first adventure with the new Robin and how they break up Ma Gunn's nasty school. It's not bad. The writing is competent. It is written by Max Collins, who regularly writes the Ms. Tree series. It's about a female detective for Renegade Comics. And Collins is an excellent writer. He's very capable, and I have to say that I'm glad to see him on the Batman book. The art is by Ross Andrew, and it is inked by Dick Giordano, and it's not bad either. It's, again, very competent, but it's not outstanding. The book itself is not outstanding, and ordinarily, I would say that it's a very good Batman adventure. It's especially good if you're just getting in on the ground floor of Batman. If you haven't been reading his comics for a while and you think you might want to try him again, this is a good time to pick up the book. But it's not really that unusual, and I don't see how they can label it as a new adventure, because it really isn't that new. It's pretty typical Batman stuff, and I don't like what they did with the new Robin. I don't think it's very good. If you haven't been reading Batman comics for a long time, you will probably enjoy it a lot more than I did. Again, it's suitable for anyone of any age. There is no reference to graphic sex or drugs or violence. There was no kind of obscene language. It is all very good, wholesome adventure. I think it would probably be more suited to younger readers. Older readers might not enjoy it as much. But that's Batman issue 409, The New Adventures. The next book which we're going to discuss is Shazam, The New Beginning, Issue 3. Now, this, as you may be able to guess from the title, is another revitalized comic book about a superhero who has been given a new look. This is the third issue of a mini-series which is detailing the brand new origin story of Captain Marvel. Captain Marvel is a superhero who has been around since the 1940s. Originally, he was published by a rival comic book company as a copy of Superman. But DC Comics bought up the rights to Captain Marvel years after he first was published, and they've been putting him into comic books off and on ever since. Now, this miniseries is 4 issues long. It's available on your local newsstands, and you should be able to pick up a copy of the first 2 issues right now, as a matter of fact. It's a pretty good series. It puts a lot of new elements into the Captain Marvel story, changes things around a great deal, and it's actually pretty interesting. If you're just getting back into comic books again, if you haven't read them for a while, I think you'll enjoy this book because it enables you to start off fresh with a brand new character. You'll learn all about him, you learn all about how he came to be, and what he's all about, what his powers are, what he's going to do in the world, and it's actually quite exciting. I think you'll enjoy it. It's very well done. The scripting is by Roy Thomas. He's a comic book writer who wrote the old Conan series for Marvel Comics, and he's been around for a number of years. He's very famous in the comic book industry, and he's has a very good touch for old characters, for old superheroes, and for revitalizing them, for giving them a new look. He does an excellent job with Shazam, The New Beginning. I recommend this book. It's Shazam, The New Beginning, Issue 3. Give yourself a chance and pick it up. It's very good. Now, next I'd like to talk about some exceptional comic books. These are all comics which are geared towards audiences of all ages. They're suitable for young readers and for older readers, and I think anyone would enjoy these books. They are very well done. This is a book called Legion of Superheroes. It's about a group of superheroes in the far future, in the 30th century to be exact, and they battle all kinds of supervillains and intergalactic forces which threaten the planet Earth and the United Federation of Planets in that time period. It's a very good book. This is issue 36 of Legion of Superheroes. It involves the election of a new leader for the group, and the leader who was elected, I'm not going to tell you who it is, but you can find out for yourself by buying the book. It's very exciting. It's a very well done series. It's written by a man named Paul Levitz, who is very capable, and it is drawn by a man named Greg LaRocque, and it is inked by a man named Larry Malstedt. They have all done some exceptional work in the past, and this is additionally very good work. I recommend it. It's a lot of fun. It's got a lot of excitement in it, some good characterization, some fabulous art, and some really colorful and intriguing characters. And I recommend you try to find a copy of this if possible. The only way you can get Legion of Superheroes is by going to a comic book specialty shop. Now, there are no comic book shops in Johnstown at the current time, but you can drive to Indiana and go to a store there called Patty's Paperbacks. That's really the nearest location where you can find books like this, which are distributed only to comic book shops. Another great comic book which is being put out right now is called Silver Surfer. It's published by Marvel Comics, which published the Alpha Flight and Daredevil comics, and the NOM also. Silver Surfer is marvelous. This is one of my all-time favorite comic book characters. It is about a cosmic superhero called the Silver Surfer, and he rides through the cosmos on a special silver surfboard. He has superpowers from a force called the Power Cosmic, which is sort of an amplified version of the Force from Star Wars. It's a very good book. It has a lot of science fiction elements in it, a lot of superhero elements in it, and it's just so well done. The art is by a man named Marshall Rogers, and Marshall Rogers is one of the best. I mean, one of the best. He ranks up there with John Byrne and George Perez as a fabulous comic book artist. And it is written by Steve Englehart, who is also very, very good in comics. And I just can't recommend this enough. It's the first issue of a new regular series, and I think that anyone would enjoy this book. This is issue number 1 of The Silver Surfer. It's available at your local newsstands. You don't have to go to a comic book shop to get a copy. It's a little more expensive. It's $1.25, but it's worth it. The art is just incredible, and the story is also very, very fine. So I recommend you pick that up. Another book which is very well done, which is also published by Marvel Comics, is The Incredible Hulk. Now, believe it or not, this is a pretty good book. I have not been crazy about the character of the Hulk for a long, long time. He was never one of my favorite heroes. Generally, his adventures have been very bland and not very exciting. I always enjoyed the TV series, which starred Bill Bixby and Lou Ferrigno. I always liked that a lot. It was always pretty interesting. But the comic just never really grabbed my attention. Anyhow, in recent years, they've been changing the Hulk around a good deal. For a while, he had intelligence, and then he didn't, and then he was separate from Bruce Banner, and then he wasn't, and many different things have been changed in the series in the past years. This is issue number 332 of the Hulk, and it is currently available at your local newsstands. You don't have to go to a comic book shop to get it, and it is very good. It's really a lot of fun, and I recommend it. If you've ever heard of the Hulk, and I'm sure everyone out there has, you'll like this book. It's written by a man named Peter David, and it's drawn by an artist named Todd McFarlane. And McFarlane is excellent. He did some very good work on a comic called Infinity Incorporated for DC for about 2 years or 3 years, and he's very good. It's a very colorful comic. It's very interesting. The Hulk is now reverted to his original form. Back when he first came out, he had gray skin. Now he has gray skin again. And his friend Rick Jones is now the green-skinned version of the Hulk. It's pretty strange, but it's very interesting and colorful, and I think you'll enjoy it. It's good for readers of all ages, no graphic violence or sex or obscene language or any kind of drug references or anything like that. And that's all the time that we have tonight. I hope you'll go out and try some of the comic books which I talked about in tonight's edition of Comic Book World. And I hope you'll stay tuned for another edition of this program, which will be coming your way hopefully in another few weeks. In the meantime, give comic books a chance. They're a lot better than they used to be.
Say no more.